There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. To break every chain, break every chain, break every...
Good evening, everyone. Welcome to He's Real, He's Listening. And I'm your host, Luis Feliciano. I want to thank God for allowing me to be here, like I do every single Saturday. I'm going to open up with a prayer and ask the Holy Spirit to guide us to what we're about to do. Lord, we thank you so much for allowing us to be here today, for allowing us to, protecting us during the week, going to work, coming back home, and protecting us today through the morning all the way into this afternoon. I thank you, Lord, for using my voice to let people know out there that you are real and you are listening when we place our prayer towards you. We ask you, Lord, to guide what we're about to do. I ask you, Lord, to guide the speaker that I asked in the last minute and she said yes. I thank God for that. And I know this is all led by you, oh God. And I thank you for allowing us to be here and to ready to share of the powerful testimony of what you do when we submit a 100% towards you and the way you transform our lives. And to let those out there know that without you, there ain't nothing they could do, and things will not go right unless they have you guiding them in their daily life. We ask you to guide us, protect us, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Welcome, everyone, again to He's Real, He's Listening. I want to thank God for allowing me to be here again. Like I said, every single Saturday that I come and sit here, I still can't believe that I'm doing this. But when you are led by the Holy Spirit and God touches you in a way that when He knows that He places an assignment in your hand, you must do it because it is what we pray for, and I always pray to God that to use me to bring lost souls and people that are hurting to know that that hurting that they is inserted in their heart, there is a cure for it, and that is with you, oh Lord. Before I introduce my speaker, just want to say my week went very well. What I love is the way God protects us going to work. You know, I have the blessing and the honor of going on the bus with my wife, Sylvia, and she's sitting right here next to me. I thank God that she had joined us. And like I do every single day, I always post something on Facebook, and there's a reason behind that, because the day I set eyes on her, I always tell her these words that I will always tell her the way I feel. Whether I could be sitting on the bus, I could close my eyes, and if I feel something to write on Facebook for her, she could be sitting right next to me and I'll still write it. Because when I ask God to bless me with someone, not only had God blessed me with someone, but He had blessed me with an unbelievable wife. And I say this with my open heart, because I never knew how to respect women until God gave me Sylvia. And when we met, I was still a little tough in the edges. And through God's grace and mercy and through her guidance, she helped me become who I am today. And I thank God for that, because that's what I always wanted. I always knew that you have to respect women, but the way I was brought up, it was taught differently. But when I became a father and a husband myself, then I realized what it is to respect a woman. And I thank her for that, for showing me that. And now I see what it is, why it is to respect the women out there. And I don't know about anybody else, but when I see someone like disrespecting, I don't know why it's going there, but when I see someone like talking rough or saying something not nice to a woman, it just gets me edgy. And sometimes I do, I will walk up someone and say, there's no reason for you to speak that way. You could do that somewhere else, but in front of me, don't do it. I don't know why, but that person looks at me and said, you know, every woman should be respected and shouldn't be spoken like that in front of other people. And that's just me. But the great thing about it, they understand, they look at me and say, you know what, I'm thank you for telling me that. And they change their way and they stop doing it. The person that I'm going to introduce, she's very special in my life. And the way it happened for her coming here, I was walking, and I always ask God this when I'm ready to come to the show. I look through my phone book, or I look through my phone, and I ask God, guide me, who do you want me to bring to the show to share their testimony? And you came to my mind. I want to say your name until I'm ready to. You came into my mind. And it's funny, I'm walking and I say, okay. And as soon as I said something, I told her, honey, I'm thinking, she said, you know what's so funny? She tells me I was thinking about the same person. So once she said that was already a confirmation. And that's the way the Holy Spirit leads you. And the reason why, because I've seen, you know, you guys don't know this. The first time I saw you guys walk into the church, I don't tell you things, but I say, and I know. One of the things that I saw the glow. And when I see someone with the glow of God, that gives me a joy that I cannot explain to anyone. like we were talking about you, me and my wife was talking about you. We said, oh my God, you could see the difference. And that is the glory of God. You could tell that God has changed your heart. Because I remember when we used to speak about God or something, you could tell with people, they give you that puzzled look and they give you like, okay. You know what it is? I was the same way. There was no one in this world that could have tried to insert God into my heart. I would lock you down. I would say, do me a favor, don't speak about God to me, because I was so angry and so upset at the time. But it came to the moment that I had to do something. It came to a moment that I was in a dark place that I didn't want to live anymore. So now I had to make a choice, or to stay alive. And the only way I was going to stay alive is by letting God into my heart, because I already knew God. And once I let that happen, I told God, please come back into my life. My life was transformed. So without further ado, the person I'm about to introduce, we met, I think maybe like 5-6 years ago, maybe. And one of the things that captured my heart was that I remember, I think when we met, she said something to me that it stung me, because we had just met. She said, you know what? I want you to be like, how can I call you dad? If I remember clearly. And I remember looking at her saying, but she said, but there's something up. She told me there's something about you that I really love, and that I could see the gift of a father to a daughter. And I remember that we cried in the hallway, me, you, and Sylvia. Mm-hmm. And it was such a blessing that even though we separated in connecting, but you always stood in my heart as my daughter, because once you insert that and it's sealed, there's nobody out there that could change that. Yeah. It stays there. So I asked in the last minute, I think it was maybe, why is it like this morning, I text her, will you be interested in coming to speak on my show? And I think maybe 10-15 minutes later, I got a response, and she said, sure, I'll come speak on your show. And when I see that, you could tell that's the confirmation of God, because if it's going to happen, it's going to happen. There's not, we could do it and you can do it. Once God says it, you do it in here. Mm-hmm. So without further ado, I'm going to let her come and share her powerful testimony, which I had heard, and I think is, I know, as what I heard and what I see today and what she used to be, it's going to change someone's life out there. And I introduce you to my sister, my AKA daughter, Elise.
Hi, Sailor family. I want to thank Lewis, who is a brother and been a father to me for a while, for inviting me on the show. I'm sorry if I get a little bit of emotional, but it's just so crazy, because when I sit back and think of my life before, I dealt with a lot of abuse. And, you know, I came from a good home. My dad tried to be there, give me the best things, but that was all material. And one thing is, material things can always be replaced, but love can't. And Louis and Sylvia showed me the love from parents. And yes, we separated because, you know, I went astray in my things. And it wasn't until recently that I chose to give myself completely to God. And I'm so grateful for that, because when I look at my past, you know, I was looking for love in the wrong places from different men. And because I didn't have my dad there, so I would always look for men to love me. And all I got from that was abuse. You know, talking down to and physical abuse, mental, physically, emotionally, and I felt like nobody. And God had put people in my life that numerous times I failed to see, but He never gave up. He always put somebody else in my path. And I love Him dearly for that, and which is why I gave myself to Him completely, because out of all the men I've ever put in my life, He's the one that's always loved me unconditional. Mm-hmm. And He has sent many people to love me as well and pray over me and keep me safe. But the main person that's kept me safe is Him. Which brings me back to, you know, my past again. All that led to drug addiction and being lost, you know, trying to find different ways to make myself feel good. And through that, I would always get on my knees and I would pray, like, why am I doing this? And, you know, somebody come and help me. And people came into my life, but then again, I got sidetracked again, because the enemy was always there, like stating, oh, you're not good enough, you know. Nobody's ever going to love you. And people would tell me that. Like, the devil would use the people that love me the most to tell me You know what? If I don't love you, nobody's gonna love you. If you're not with me, you're not gonna be with nobody. And that would really like hurt me. That I would really think, wow, I have nobody. If I don't stay with this person that's abusing me, I'm not gonna have nobody. So I was like kept in this trap, you know. And after a while, after getting older and still wanting to hang out with different friends, I started to get older and started to realize, you know, that's not the man for me. And at one point, I got smart, you know. And I prayed to God. I said, you know what, God? I don't want a man that's going to cheat on me, that's going to hit me, that's going to talk down to me. All I want is a man who's going to love me and want me. Ooh, did I got what I asked for? I tell you, I'm married to my husband. Amen. For 3 years.
God is good.
And he loves me with all his heart. And at times I look up at the Lord and I say, Lord, what did I ask for? Because he loves me dearly. And I thank God for that every day. But there's reasons why God took me to those dark places. Because in those dark places, I learned what real love was. It wasn't from those guys, you know? The real love was the fact that I would get down on my knees and he would always be there. And what I'm mistaken before was I wanted things done in my time, you know? And I wasn't patient. And if you know God, you gotta know patience and you gotta know love and you gotta know how to be obedient. And I wasn't obedient. I didn't want to be obedient. I didn't want to wait for him to bless me with that special somebody, you know? And little did I know that when he did bless me with that somebody, I was going to be changing that somebody's life too. You know, he was saving me for that special somebody who needed me. And I didn't know that. You know, you think, oh, this person's got to be for me. But what if it's not for you, but you're for that person? You know what I mean? And eventually, you guys are for each other. And you don't stop to think about those things in those times. But now, I realize his purpose, you know. Before, I it was hard for me to conceive children. You know, I dealt with a lot of abuse where I couldn't hold my babies in my womb, you know. And today, I can say I'm a mother of 2 children that I birthed myself. And a stepdaughter that is my daughter as well, you know. So I just had to realize that God doesn't rush perfection. Mm-hmm. My children are perfect to me. And God doesn't rush things like that. But you have to be patient. And, you know, I was nervous on coming on the radio station today to talk. But when Louis asked me to talk, like he said, I look at him as a father. So I want to be obedient now. You know, when I look at him, he shows me the love that my father in reality is too busy to show me. You know, and I pray for my father every day. And there's probably other people out there who feel the same way. You know, their parents are caught up in their daily activities or they don't know God and they're not able to show their kids the love. But just know that God has a special somebody out there for you. That is ready to show you that love. You just got to be willing to accept it. A lot of people get nervous and get I want to use the right word, almost like scared, because they don't know that love, you know, and they're not open to it because they never felt that, you know. When you don't know love and somebody's trying to show you that, right away you want to think the person's crazy. You know what I mean? Oh my gosh, what's wrong with this person? This person's acting too nice. Something's not right, you know? But that's just God putting that special someone in your life. And I'm not saying you got to trust everybody, because like my pastor was saying, there's those covenant relationships. You know what I mean? You got to be careful who you allow in your life at the same time, because the enemy will deceive you and he will put people in your life that you think are loving you. And in all reality, they just want to see you get, you know, destroyed in the long run. And I learned that the hard way. Friends that I thought were friends, you know, were trying to tear up my marriage, me not even realizing it. Oh, hey, let's go out. My husband's home. No, she's a married woman now. Oh, but I just wanted to come out with me. And me being naive to it, I was feeding into it, not realizing I was messing up my marriage. You know, when my husband's been there day in and day out, and there was times where I thought, man, this isn't going to work, because I was trying to please myself. Not taking into consideration the blessing that I've been blessed with, my family, my household. You know, there's women out there who have babies with men and the man leaves them, or they're out there fornicating and you know, they're coming home to their wife and meanwhile they were just with the other person, and I don't have that, you know? So why shouldn't I give my husband that respect to want to stay home with him and show him? And you know what? One day I'm gonna just keep it real. One of my friends, she invited me out, and my husband was, don't go out. That I literally told her, stop the car, and I made her bring me back home, and I got out the car because I needed to prove who was more important to me at that time. My blessing, there was nobody that was going to rob me of my blessing that the Lord had blessed me with. And many times, you know, you think of divorce because you can't handle it. And at the one time, I was on the brink of divorce, and my sister had invited me to a encounter, and that is where you encounter the Holy Spirit. And you know, I prayed, I said, you know what, Lord, I don't know if this decision I'm about to make is gonna be the right decision, you know, but I need to be led right now. So if this is where I need to be, then this is where I'm gonna go. So I went, and immediately when I get there, you know, there's women, their testimonies are about their marriages and how their marriages were saved because Jesus, not because the counseling service, not because Dr. Phil, because Jesus was active in their marriages, in their life, because they allowed him to work in their marriages. And I thought to myself, what am I thinking? You know, I went home and I told my husband, babe, I love you. You know, sometimes I get crazy. I don't know what I'm talking about. But just don't mind that, you know. And I'm grateful because he's never decided to pack up and leave, you know. And it's been hard because I've always been about the Lord in my heart, you know. And when you have somebody that's not there yet, you know, you kind of battle. You try to please that person, and you drift away, and you fall back. But I'm grateful to the fact that I've always come back. And at one point, I was alone in that walk. And now I'm grateful to say that my husband is along in that walk with me.
Amen.
And it took some obstacles, some turns, some hills, you know, but we're there together. And I heard one time, what you feed your spirit will become. Okay? And that saying right there changed my life when I heard it. Because I was feeding my spirit negative stuff. I was allowing negative to happen in my home, around my kids, where I was at. You know, and I'm not saying it's us, but where we were. You know, if you bring your kids around certain friends, you know, expose them to certain things, you're allowing that to build up in their spirit. You're allowing that. You're saying it's okay, and it's not, you know? And when I came back from the encounter, I said, Lord, I'm going to give myself to you completely. I'm all yours. Enough playing games, enough not being obedient, you know? And whoever's going to join me on this walk is going to join me whether they're going to join me or whether they're not going to join me, but I'm going to keep moving forward. That's what I told myself. And I prayed, and everything started to fall into place, you know? And I'm very grateful because I wake up in the morning now and nothing is the same. I don't look at things the same. Even if I wake up upset or confused or not knowing where it's going to, my day's going to head, I just close my eyes and I pray, Lord, please get me through this thing, you know? And He answers me. And like with like little things, like I'll go on and I'll see an inspiring post left by somebody, or I'll turn on the radio and there it goes right there, you know, and it's just confirmation that I'm not alone no matter where I go, you know, He's always there. And I prayed for that, you know, for people in my family to witness that, because a lot of people fall behind because, and they don't open up because they look for signs, you know. Oh, since I haven't seen this, or this hasn't happened to me, then it's not there, you know. And I've learned to accept that because I can't see Him, He's still there. Mm-hmm. But not many people could do that. And I've prayed for that, you know, over my husband within the past couple weeks at a revival service, you know. I prayed, I said, Lord, you know, I want him to know what I know. I want him to feel what I feel so that we can walk together. Mm-hmm. And I was praying. And the enemy tried to get him out of there because, you know, they were calling to pick up my kids. And I said, no, babe, you better turn back around. The enemy's trying to steal you of your blessing. And he turned back around and they ministered over my husband's life, you know, over mine and my husband's. And when he felt what I felt, it was like a blessing that nobody could ever explain, because now we walk together. You know, we have our disagreements because we're human, but nothing is done without being led by the Lord and the Holy Spirit. You know, we pray all the time. My kids wake up in the morning and they pray. My kids tell me if I try to sneak a bite of the food before I pray, they're like, Mommy, you didn't say grace. And I'm like, oh man, I said it in my head. You're too slow. And they're correcting me already, you know? And I got my kids in daycare, you know, saying their little Bible verses to other kids. And that's just an amazing feeling, because that just goes to show how far I've come as a parent, as a woman, you know. And I told myself today, I said, Lord, I don't know what I'm going to say. You know, I don't know why you want me to do this. But you know what? It's just confirmation of where the Lord has brought me. You know, where He's taking me from the pits of where He's taking me from, the darkest moments where I was in a corner crying because I had nobody. And now I have so many people who say, Elise, you are so happy all the time. Mm. No matter what you're going through, you always got a smile on your face. And they're like, why is that? And all I can say is, that's Jesus. And they look at me like, are you serious? That is Jesus. I serve an awesome God. You have no idea how awesome He is. And then they're asking me, well, you need to pray for this for me. And I'm like, why don't you just close your eyes and try to pray? You know what I mean? You don't need somebody to pray for you. You could close your eyes and pray yourself. It's that people think you need people to pray for you. No. God opened those doors for us that we could pray for ourselves and for our family to save others. You know? And people don't realize that. And it's just a blessing that we take for granted. And everybody out there needs to know that you have an option to be loved by the most amazing man in the world. Whether it's that you come from a house with no father, or a house of abuse, you know what I mean? He is always there to lift you up. Don't be afraid to get on your knees and open your arms up. and have him pick you up, you know what I mean? Because he'll be there for you, you know? And I'm blessed. I just have no other way to say it, you know? And I'm blessed to have the people that I have in my life, you know? I'm blessed for having this opportunity to share my testimony, because I come from a very dark place, a place of hurt, a place of pain, you know? And a lot of people think that nobody knows their story. They sit there and they're like, why are you looking at me like that? You don't know me. Mm-hmm. You know, they see me always talking about my God, but they don't see what I've been through and where he's brought me from. You know what I mean? They see the beautiful side of what I allowed the Lord to expose mm-hmm. of me, you know? And it says when you walk with the Lord, you give yourself a new name. You lose the old you. You know what I mean? Yes, I'm Elise. Elise Rodriguez, now Caballero. Yes, people know me because of what I've done in my past. And I'm not saying it was the most horrible thing, because I was never a horrible person. But I've made mistakes. You know what I mean? I've exposed myself to things that I could have possibly lost my life. You know what I mean? And yes, that was me. But now I'm Elise, the child of God, who walks as his child. So I'm still me, but I have given myself a new name as his child. You know what I mean? I'm the new Elise, and I'm proud of that. You know, no matter what people could say, sit there and say, you know, I'm a new me. And I know that. And people who know me know that. And that's all that matters. My God knows that, you know? And there's things that, you know, like I have tattoos. And somebody once said, people walking around with tattoos are God's new warriors. Okay? Because a lot of people from the streets have given themselves to the Lord. And people look down on them because of their tattoos, but they don't realize that they're God's warriors. Like, they see them walking around like these masculine, you know, bullies, and they're children of God, you know. And so it doesn't matter where you come from, you know what I mean? God has a place for you, and God has purpose in your life, you know. And everybody needs to know that. I'm just happy. And I don't know if my husband wants to share, but he's been in this battle with me, and I'm grateful for him, you know. Mm-hmm. And if you have that special someone out there, cherish that, you know, whether it's a mom who loves you, a dad who loves you, a sister who loves you, a brother who loves, cherish that. A husband, a wife. Because when somebody loves you, they love you with their all. And you can tell that. You know what I mean? Especially, you know, you can feel it in your heart. And now I love differently. Because I love, when I love, it burns from the inside out. You know, because I love like God loves now. You know, even on my angriest days, I can't dislike somebody. You know, people have hurt me. I'm going through stuff now, and all I can do is pray for the people who hurt me. You know what I mean? You learn not to retaliate, not to, you know, that's what you, when you're exposed to that, that's all you know. You don't know that if you pray for that person, things change. You know what I mean? God has your back. Like, some people say stuff to me or do stuff to me, and I'm like, oh boy. Like, do you know what you just did? Like, it's a blessing to know that I have him on my side, and everybody can have that, you know? And I'm grateful for being able to be here today. I couldn't be more grateful, because now I hope I touch somebody out there who's going through whatever they're going through, or is lost, or, you know, there's hope. You just got to be patient and know that God doesn't rush perfection. You'll have that perfect marriage. You'll have that perfect relationship. You'll have that perfect child. You know what I mean? You just got to pray. And if you pray, the doors will open. If you surrender and you give yourself to the Lord, He will be there for you, you know? Like, I'm not saying you're not going to, you know, mess up from time to time. It's a walk, and you fall, you know? But like children fall. And you give them your hand, and you pick them up, you know? And that's what the Lord does. You're going to fall, but He's going to pick you up. Like a parent does, He's going to brush you off. And if you need to fall again, He's going to let you fall, but He'll pick you back up. You know? But just know He's your Father, and He loves you. And you could always turn to Him. Okay?
Amen, amen. You know what happens when I hear testimony like yourself? Every single person that has sat there, what you just did, what it does to me, it makes me fall in love more with Jesus.
Amen.
Because, like I said, I know Elise, I met Elise, and I know when she was in that dark world, I met her. And, you know, I used to do a small group in my home when I first came to the Lord. And it was something that God put in my heart and in my spirit. And through those small group meetings that we used to have in our home, me and Sylvia, we saw so many people be transformed. And I will never forget. I saw so many people walk through that door. I'm talking about trembling. I mean, talking... You said so many unbelievable nuggets that it's so weird that me and Sylvie was, look, my head stands up. Because me, a lot of the stuff that you shared, you ain't going to believe this. I wish we could have recorded and me and Sylvie spoke about it. Spoke about the love, spoke about the trust, spoke about the identity of who we are and how God gave it to us. You said so many unbelievable, I'm telling you, I was here, I was like, did that one record? Did she hear us? But you see how you could tell that this station is connected to the Lord? Mm-hmm. Because the way God does that, I text you, you hear, you share your powerful testimony. But what I love and see is the sincerity. And I see the belief and I see the truth. And like I told you, I saw you both come into our church and I saw the glory in God in both. Not in one, but in both. And one thing that we did share, and it's so funny, do you see what God is doing, right? The power of prayer. We spoke about last week's title was the importance of prayer. And you notice, Elise came, I don't know if you heard the show or not, you came and you spoke about the power of prayer. And that is the reason why you are sitting there with your husband. And I always tell that to people. When I see me and Sylvia sit and try to counsel someone or a person or someone, and we see that there's nothing we could really do, you know what I do? I said, there's only one more thing that I could do for you, that which I know we can, and that's pray to God. And then look at me. I said, I'm telling you right now, the reason why I'm sitting here, Sylvia's here, and I'm pretty sure my guest here, because of the power of prayer. Mm-hmm. It's the most powerful tools in our own lives. It's something that I always say, pray, pray, pray. Why am I sitting here? Because of that one prayer that I put to God. I gave God that prayer like it was like a challenge. It was like I said, all right, now I'm going to ask you this. I want you to show me the real God that you really are. I want you to take this addiction away from my life. And then you show me, and I want to see you real. And what did he do? Not only did he took away the addiction, but he took away all those character defects that I had. Anger, depression, sadness, all that. But the secret is I had to pray one by one on all of them because it was hard to let go. Mm-hmm. You share something which, I mean, I'm so glad you shared it. The part about the love. That's the second. It's funny that you see. We could check our DNA, and we could be like, you're really my daughter, and I'm your dad, because I went through that challenge. Because the way I was brought up, I surrounded myself with a shield, and what that shield did, I could have walked up to anybody. Everybody could walk up to you and say, "Oh, I love you," and I would look at you and say, "Man, do me a favor, don't say those words." You know why? Because if I did not get that love and unconditional love from my parents, who are you that I don't even know you're gonna show me that? So you know what I would do? Is so I don't know if you did the same thing. I would walk away from that person. I would take him out of my life because I said, I don't trust him. I don't believe him. Get out of here. You don't love me. You don't know me. How are you going to tell me you love me? And when people used to say to me, I used to rebuke them. I said, how can you say that? You don't even know me. Don't say the word love you. You don't even know what it means. Yeah. But you said, but then little by little, God did something when I put that powerful prayer in. Little by little, he started opening up those shields. You know why? Because this is what I tell Sylvia a lot of time. We waste our time so much trying to find a love of someone that we love, like your mother, your brother, your sister, your grandfather, your uncle, and they don't understand that powerful love, that what you do, you got to leave it in God. And let, what we do, we don't let that person that really want to give you the love, we push them away. You know what I learned? I said, you know why? It's okay. They know, God knows my heart, and God knows that I love that family, my blood family. But you know what? I'm going to accept that love that that person want to give me. I told that to Sylvia all the time. Mm-hmm. And God has done something so unbelievable that before I wasn't loved by one, and today I'm loved by thousands.
Exactly. Amen.
Isn't that unbelievable? Why? Because you said a lot of, you said stuff in there that I really, that I'm glad I wasn't the only one that shaked. Sometimes people, when you hear you talking, they think, I think he knows it all. But I'm glad that you came here and spoke about stuff that I always want somebody else to say, so they could say that I'm not the only one that think I sound smart or I sound good or I'm better than you. Know it's because of what God did to you. You know why God did that? Because you said one powerful thing in there. You put 100% of your trust in God. Mm-hmm. And I always tell you, when we do that, I mean, our life is transformed. And then you pray for your husband. You know, he's sitting here, and me and Sylvia was talking about it today. He said, man, I mean, one of the things that before I came to the Lord, where I used to love feeling high. And I'm talking about with alcohol and drugs. Today, my high is seeing God transform people. It gives me such a joy when I see someone that I used to know and see him today. I mean, it tells me one thing, that the Lord we serve is unbelievable. He's powerful. I don't know if Sylvia wants to say anything. She's sitting next to me. Something that she heard that touched her, that, you know, that someone out there wanted to hear and listen and understand. Well,
Elise did mention something that kind of brought back to mind my life, too. Because when you're in that dark place and you're in so much pain and you're looking for all this love and all this attention in the wrong places, for some reason, you always end up praying to God. And that, I think, even though we're not making our right choices, but that opens the path for us, because we're still relying on God, even though we make the wrong decisions. Mm-hmm. But in the long run, we come to reality. We say, God, I need your help. I need help. I need to get out of here. I need to find the right path, you know? And I know I did that many times. And many times I would go back and still make the wrong decisions and end up crying and saying, God, why did I do this? Why did I do that? But having that trust in him and knowing that you can always come back to God and he'll still hold you in his arm, pick you up, and give you the strength and love that you need, the unconditional love to give you the blessings that you really deserve in life. You know, and it's so amazing, because not only does he bless you, he blesses the people around you. He blesses you with people that have the same blessings, that have the same belief, that trust in God, that want to walk in that path, you know. And you'll see it in your children, like you just said. You know, you before that, you've had miscarriages. You never was able to carry a baby full term. And look what God did in your life, because you put your whole faith and your whole trust in God, and you were patient. Because you see, a lot of times we get antsy. We want to do things. We want it our way. We want God to bless us now. You know, yet when we don't want to give up our habits now, we want to give it up on our time. Mm-hmm. But when we want God to work in our life, we want God to do it now. You know, and it's like, okay. And we have to learn, you know. God says, you know, okay, yeah, you know, oh, now you want me to take care of you. Now you want me, you know what? I'm gonna bless you, but it's gonna be on my term, you know. And that's what I find so amazing, and it's so great to see you guys here. You know, it's
Thank
a blessing,
you.
And the biggest blessing is that your children are seeing this. They're reaping this blessing because you, as parents, are instructing them in the right direction. And that's so amazing, because they can avoid going through the headaches and the pain and the suffering that you two had gone out in the past, because you didn't have that direction back then, you know. But they with God's praise and God's blessing, they'll be able to enjoy things
Amen.
The way that it's meant to be, the way God means for all of us to have it.
You want to hear something so amazing that as Sylvie was talking and hearing your testimony and seeing both of you sitting in front of me, I don't know if anybody ever told you this, and I'm going to tell you because I've seen you, I met you before, and I don't know if anybody ever told you this, but you know what you both did? I don't know if you're aware of. You broke the cycle of your family pain.
Yes.
And in regards to, and I'm going to say it because it happened to me, mm-hmm. in regards to being parents to your children. Look, my head just, you know why I say that? Because I used to use that excuse. Like, why am I going to love my children, or why am I going to love somebody else when it wasn't given to me? And that attitude, like you stated, that spirit, we put it in our mouth. And you know what happens? It goes into our mind. And then we don't want to be the parent. But you guys showing me something, which I love to see every Sunday when I see you both walk into that church. And I tell everybody this. Why I love my church so much? Because I love the thing of family. It's something that I cannot describe, but it's something that I always pray in and I love to see. I love to see you walking through that door with your babies in your arm and you're carrying them and walking, getting a seat. I mean, it blows my mind. And I enjoy it because I've seen where you came from, Elise, and you have turned out to be a tremendous mom. I saw you put the picture today on Facebook regarding to your daughter, and that touched me so deeply because I want people to understand, don't take the dark past and try to replace it into your life of today. Change that, break mm-hmm. that cycle, mm-hmm. change it. Give it, you know what I wanted to always do was to change my name, and you just taught me that. Keep it, because my name is different now as a new creation.
Mm-hmm.
If I was to give a title to your testimony, it would say God gave me my ID, my
mm-hmm.
identity,
mm-hmm.
because that's what He did with you.
Yes.
And there was a time that I wanted to change. I really wanted to go pay and change my complete Feliciano because I was so angry. But today I say I'm never going to change my name. You know why? Because now it's a new Feliciano. Now it's a new legacy of what Luis Feliciano is and what I can do with others today.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I take my hat off to both of you. I love to see what you guys have done with your life. I love to see your parenting. I don't know if I tell you that. Keep your head up. Keep doing what you're doing. The most powerful thing in your love, in your family, is the prayer. Keep that in there because you taught us a humongous lesson today, and that is to trust God with everything, with all your might, 100%. I don't know, Megan, I see her husband is here sitting with us. I don't know if he has anything to say, but, you know, he doesn't really have to. I don't do that, but he's here. I welcome him. I thank him so much for coming and bringing Elise to the show. And I am so, I mean, this, you always see a testimony, but sometimes when you hear them and what God takes you out of, it's like amazing. I always was intrigued with testimony. You know why? Because behind it, shows you the power of God, what God
mm-hmm.
done. Like, it's, when I hear you speak about the dark world, it's like you just want to just fall on your knees and cry, because you probably did this too. You know, when I was in the Bronx, I used to do this like a time clock. It was, I would leave from work at 5:30, get drunk before I got home. I don't know why I used to do this. I used to go into my daughter's room. You're gonna get shocked. I don't know if I was mentioned, but I want people to understand the control and the power of being addicted to something. I used to go home, go to the store, and buy me 6 bottles to 7 of 40s. Go into my daughter's room and surround myself with the bottles. Do you know why I used to do that? I would sit in the middle of it, so when I would pass out and I would wake up, I could reach out to any of the bottles. It wouldn't be far away from me. And I would do this in my daughter's room. And that is why you see me sitting here, and I'm always writing on Facebook the gratitude that I have to my Father, like you say, my God. I mean, if you want your life to be transformed, just place that 100% in His hand. Don't have 1 foot in and 1 foot out.
Mm-hmm.
You did something which I love, which I saw it myself with the baby. I love that, how you call it, that thing you just did with, if your baby falls, reach out, pick him up. And that's the way our God is. We could, no matter how many times you fall, God always has His hand like this. All you gotta do is reach up and grab it.
Mm-hmm.
I believe that 100%, because like you said, there's what I love you said in your testimony also, you know, so many things you said, but it's so powerful that you think about it because it happened to yourself. Mm-hmm. And you also mentioned the part about when you're in the dark world, you could come to the light. You have a choice. You have an option. Mm-hmm. And I'm glad that God gives us that choice that we could come to the light. I don't know if Sylvia has anything to say. I don't know if you want to say anything else that way.
But let me say something else, too. For everybody out there listening, I just want you to know that the Lord has written a love letter for everybody, and it's called the Father's Love Letter. So, you know, if you have time, Google it. Mm-hmm. Father's Love Letter. Mm-hmm. It's all scriptures from the Bible that he put together as a written love letter for us, you know, and he declares his love in this love letter. And at the encounter, that love letter was played because the name of the encounter was The Greatest Love Story Ever Told. Okay, which struck home because, like I said, my marriage was going downhill. And I'm like, what in the world? What did I come to right now? The Greatest Love Story Ever Told. That was the heading. And then they play this love letter from God that I didn't even know existed. You know, maybe if somebody would have shared that information with me a long time ago, I would have been like, wow, somebody loves me. And I would have just forgot about all the negative stuff, and I would have just kept it moving from there. But you know what? I learned a lot in my path. And before, I remember the one time I was arguing with my husband, right? Mm-hmm. And I looked up at a shooting star, and I wished for something, right? Mm-hmm. But that doesn't happen from wishing from a shooting star, you know? It comes from the faith of the Lord. Mm. Exactly. Because when I got on my knees and I prayed for it, yeah, man, that came like this, like in the blink of an eye. My prayers got answered. It wasn't from me wishing on a shooting star or blowing out a candle, making a wish, none of that. It was because I closed my eyes and I prayed with sincere feeling. Mm-hmm. Lord, help me. Mm. You know what I mean? Yeah. And I suggest that, you know, you get on Google, because everybody Googles for every other reason. You know what I mean? Get on Google and read that love letter that he has written for his children. And know that there is a true love. That's true. Okay? And it starts with him. Mm. You know? And I'm thankful for being here. I'm thankful for being able to share my testimony, for having, you know, my parents in Christ here with me, Sylvia and Louie, and for them never giving up on me, because they were one of the many people that took me in their arms and said, no matter what happens, you always have a mom and dad here. Mm-hmm. And that meant the world to me. You know what I mean? And I just couldn't be happier. My husband's here by my side, and I was going crazy because my kids were taking their time eating, and I'm thinking, how am I going to make it in time to get here? And then I'm like, babe, do you mind if I go by myself? And he's like, nope, I got a babysitter. I'm going with you. So, you know, he was here to support me in this. Amen. You know, amen. Even if he didn't say nothing, he's right here by my side. I want everybody to know that, you know, and I'm grateful for that. But I wish blessings on everybody's household and in their lives. You know, starting today, if you haven't heard it before, you know, I pray that from here on out, things look brighter for you. Mm-hmm. And that you accept Jesus Christ as your Savior. You know what I mean? Because once you do that, sky's the limit, baby. That's all I gotta say.
Sure.
Sky's the limit. So.
And I'll share, but it's not ready yet.
Okay, I know you would. That's what I'm saying. You know, whenever you're ready. But I'm grateful too that when I saw At Least Come You Can with her, and I recommend to couples to always do things together. I mean, it's one of the things that, like today, this is our day today. Me and Sylvia, we got up. We made plans. We got up, right. We went and took the car in. That's one thing that when I'm home, me and Sylvia do everything together since we've been together the last 13, 14 years. Everything we do together. I don't care if it's walking to the street, to go into the, whatever it is, we do everything together. Walking in the park, we go together, even though sometimes not in the mood.
That's your choice, right?
No, our choice, together. Yeah. Our choice.
My wife likes being independent.
No, me and her do everything, and I recommend that because it has made us into a strong, loving couple. Because sometimes when she don't come on the bus with me, and I lie to you, I feel depressed, I feel down, because I'm so used to having her sit next to me.
What? I understand. I know.
And they think that, and you know what's good? They sometimes you think you keep it quiet, but then she feels the same way. So that makes me feel good, because I don't want to feel the only one feeling that. I want her to feel it as well, and she does. And I'm going to share this because that's we got like 8 minutes. And a movie that we saw today, which I recommend. Usually I don't do this, but this movie was so powerful. The name of the movie is Lukewarm. W-A-R-M. Lukewarm. It's such a powerful movie that you, when you see a movie like that, you sit and you look at it and you say, why that name of that movie, right? Just, you find it so interesting, intriguing that you really want to know what's behind this movie. But I saw something in there that really, really, I mean, I'm sitting there and I'm thinking I'm not going to cry, but when I see something so touching, I don't care who you are, I don't care where I'm sitting, even my granddad was in front of me and she's seeing my teeth getting water and I'm turning my face, you will feel it. This man is an older man. He's walking in the street and he's giving out pamphlet, a Christian pamphlet to the people. He'll go and say, "Here, God bless you." And he walked to a park and he see these three girls saying, "Oh, I got something for you." He said, "What you got?" And he gave her the pamphlet, right? And he kept going. Some people looked at him again, but then he did something that really, I mean, blew my mind. As he's walking through the back alley, he see a bum sitting there, and he walks up to the guy and he say, "How you doing, sir?" He said, "I'm doing fine." I said, "Can I give you this?" He said, "No, but I need food. I need this and this and that." And he did something amazing. He said, "You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to do something better. Because it looks like, you know, this pamphlet is not going to help you right now." I said, "Come with me. I'm going to treat you for lunch." Mm-hmm. The funny thing is, when he said that, I thought he was going to take him to a diner. He took him to his home. He cooked him a meal to the guy in the house. And as that guy was sitting across from him, I'm sitting here, I'm saying, "Oh my God. Isn't that a true Christian brother to do something like that, to bring a guy?" I told him, "Oh my God, he's bringing that guy to the house. We don't know who he is." But here's the power part behind this that it really blew my mind. The man got there, he sat there, and the man brought the word to him, and he gave him the Bible. Do you know that man took that Bible? He walked out of there like in stunned and in shock. He went into the shelter, and one of the girls that knows him came up to him and said, "Oh my God, I see you reading a Bible." And he had told him who gave him the Bible. And he said from that day, from that moment, he told her, "I gave my heart to the Lord." Oh, and I felt the transformation in me. Amen. But here's the most powerful part that really touches us. As he did this, the girl was so happy. She said, "You know what? Why you don't come to church tomorrow and give, you know, make it official?" The guy, I said, "I hope I don't do this without crying." Mm-hmm. The older man, the bum, said, "You know what? I want to go." And she said, "You know what? I even have a suit for you, and it'll fit you perfectly." And then he said, joking to her, "Didn't I tell you one day we were going to go on a date?" Mm-hmm. Joking around the other guy. But the sad part is that as the nighttime came, he was collecting cans. And as he crossed the street, he got hit by a drunk driver. At the moment, it broke my heart. But then I got rejoiced again. You know why? Because he gave the heart to the Lord.
Amen. Before he died.
So you imagine if he didn't do that. And my question to the listeners is this. How many of you are giving your heart to the Lord? Are you completely ready? So if something happens to you, which I pray to God it doesn't. But if it does, where will you go?
Amen.
Are you ready to accept Jesus Christ as Savior? And will you go to heaven? Because I'm one of those truly believe in that, in hell and in heaven. People think there is no hell, but I'm going to tell you something. Yes, there is. Yes, there is. It's written in the Word. So, you know, when I saw that, but it is a... So, I recommend everybody to get that movie, see it, because it had a lot of great nuggets. It has a story in the same movie regarding to forgiveness of your father, forgiveness of people. I mean, it blew my mind away, but it's a very powerful movie. So, I don't know. I just thought I'd share that. And as we got a couple of minutes, I want to thank you from the bottom of my heart that I sent you that text, Elise, and you came and shared your powerful testimony. Even though I know your testimony is more powerful because I heard it before. Mm-hmm. And one day I really, from the bottom of my heart, would like you to share, because as you know, my wife and Elise, you know, even though she didn't share, but I think she'll be okay with it as my daughter, they came from an abusive relationship. And these relationships, people think, there are a lot of women out there that think they can't get out of it. Mm-hmm. I've seen it. They think they have to stay there, like you stated in your testimony, that because you thought nobody else loved you and this person does, that you have to stay there. You know what? I rebuke that in the name of Jesus, and that's a lie. Because my wife was in a relationship for almost 20 years. She thought she couldn't get out. You know what? Look where she is today. It's us that got to make a choice, and a person that you could find, like Miguel, you find someone loving that will help you and be there and take you out of that, because I know it does happen. So do not stay in an abusive relationship, because I say this, no man should be putting their hand on a woman that she is not your daughter, unless the daughter behaves. You do a little spanking here, okay, I understand that. But no man should be putting their hand on a woman, mm-hmm. whether she's wrong or right. I truly believe in that. It's not your job to be putting your hand on a woman. Show respect. Love them. Mm-hmm. If they say something wrong, ask, say it. Teach them. Like if Sylvia says something that bothers me, you know, in the beginning, you know what we used to do in the beginning, me and Sylvia? We used to compare. When we used to be with our other exes. And you know what promise we made? Because every time we did that, it would turn into the most enraged argument and ugliness, because we would get so jealous because we love each other so much. So we made a promise the day we got married. And from that day, we said, once we get married, we become one, that comparison is over. And we haven't done that since that day. Amen. And it changed 100% completely. You make a promise to your wife, keep it. Don't wait. This is what I told me and my wife. I spoke about. Don't wait for special days to give your wife flowers or take her on a dinner. Why we all gotta wait for birthdays and anniversaries? You know what? I surprise my wife every day. Sometimes I even come home and say, "Here," she looked at me. Is today something? No, I did it because I love you and I felt like doing it and I want you to have it, and it gives joy.
Well, the best thing yet is when.
Why are you looking at me like that?
And when he's done it,
I give you flowers on Wednesday.
When he's done it at my job, all of a sudden he says, "Could you come down here? I got something for you." And I go downstairs at the courthouse. He's downstairs waiting with flowers. So I'm like, "Wow!"
I know. Amazing. I read your post. It's so cute.
She told
my love. I'll meet you at Lehigh Valley.
Ah, and we do that because one time, right? I don't know what happened one time. You know what? And that's a connection. Because one time, something we didn't do that, and we thought something happened, and it did, right? There was a crash or something, and it was it was an ugly crash. So these are things that is the reason why you stay connected, and it's, you never know. And I always make sure when she goes out, I tell this to my wife, and I'm going to tell all the ladies, you know, the women's out there, wherever you go, check your surrounding. It takes you 2 seconds. I always tell this to my wife. That's the reason why I thank God when I'm on the trains or wherever I'm at. I always look at, because you never know who's going to be your opponent. Mm-hmm. And you never know what they're going to do. I don't care. If you're a woman and you're by yourself, keep your eyes open. Just look. It takes you a second. Look at your surrounding. And if somebody comes and asks you a question, I say this from the bottom of my heart, act dumb. I'm not from around here. I'm visiting. Don't stop and give, because that's a trick to get somebody else there. And I'm going to tell you, they're using everybody. They're using kids. Oh, they're using everything tricks. So, you know, keep your eyes open.
Do I have time
to
say something real quick? No?
Yeah.
No?
Two minutes. Yeah, two minutes?
Okay. I just want to tell all you ladies out there, too. Some of you like to go out and party in the clubs and stuff, you know? Uh-oh. And you guys really need to pay attention to the fact that when you intoxicate yourself, mm-hmm. you set yourself up for failure.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Yes. You make yourself vulnerable to the opponent. Okay.
And standards get lowered.
And you have to treat yourself like the women that you are.
Amen.
Okay? Yes. Cover yourselves up. Don't, you know, you say, "Why is this guy treating me like this?" But you're allowing him because you're dressing the way you dress. Yes. You're walking the way you walk. You know, you're drinking and you're getting high and you're not on your senses. Yes,
that's right.
You have to keep yourself on your senses, okay? Where even though you don't know it, you have a Holy Spirit that lives inside you.
Amen.
That will be able to alert you when things are about to get rough. And you will know in your gut, it's time for me to do the boogie. Yeah. So, ladies, when you go out to the club, even men, you know, be careful. Be careful because you set yourself up. And
that's true.
It allows other things to happen.
You know what? There's one thing before the show is over. But there's one thing that I use and I always do. Even when I came to the Lord, I will say this. Look at yourself in the mirror. And if you're about to do something that you know doesn't appreciate the Lord, ask this question. What would Jesus do? Mm-hmm. This is what I always do. I say, "Wait a minute, would God do that?" And then I realize that, you know what? No, he wouldn't. Because you feel like God's doing this, looking at you with his arm crossed, doing, "What do you think?" Mm-hmm. So I want to thank you so much for sticking to your commitment and coming in the last minute, you know, like I wrote to you, I said, I don't know what you have planned, but if you're free, can you please? And you did, and I thank you from the bottom of my heart. We got to see you, we got to hear you, what God is doing in your life. Thank you, Miguel, for coming, bringing her. Thanks to my boo, my wifey, for coming and sitting here next to me. Thanks to Sam, Uni, and Noah for this unbelievable, you know, radio show, which I love so much. Thank you for being on the show. He's real and he's listening. God bless. Let's go. Hey.
on it. Ain't really tripping, homie, let me slam on the beat like I'm Onyx. Everybody wanna know what it is, no gin and no tonic. No chronic in my lungs, been set free, I'm done. I'm chilling at the Lord's feet, homeboy, cause you know we hung. For every sin I ever did, now that's amazing grace. Got me chilling in this place like I'm amazing. Oh yeah, this the one I'm craving. My heart was dark like a raven, that's why he came to save me. I'm talking about